Hello, this is Dr. Benjamin Norris from the Chemistry Department at Frostburg State University. Today I'm going to talk to you about what defines organic chemistry. The compound I've shown on the right is allantoin. Allantoin is found in many personal care products because of its moisturizing and emollient properties. Organic chemistry helps us understand how the structure of allantoin contributes to those properties as it interacts with molecules on your skin. Organic chemistry is also the study of how we could synthesize allantoin from simpler molecules. I also chose allantoin today because it's a diuride, a molecule that contains two urea functional groups. Urea is an important molecule in the history of organic chemistry. It plays a role in a classic experiment that demonstrates that organic compounds are not fundamentally different from inorganic compounds. So what is organic chemistry? Organic chemistry is the study of the structure and reactions of the compounds of carbon. This is the definition that has been established over the last many decades. However, organic compounds represent a large fraction of all covalent compounds, and what we come to learn about covalent bonds through our study of organic compounds can be generalized to understanding the behavior of all covalent compounds. Thus, there are some folks who would like to define organic chemistry as the study of the covalent bond. In this course, we will spend a lot of time talking about the electrons that form those bonds and what they are doing when those bonds are being formed and broken in reactions. But before we go any further, let's talk about where organic chemistry has been, because it has not always been defined as the chemistry of the compounds of carbon. So what do you think when you hear the word organic? Perhaps you think about things that are living, and certainly this is a definition of organic chemistry that used to be prominent in the previous centuries. Organic compounds were those that came from living organisms, and inorganic compounds were those that did not come from living organisms. This definition has since changed, and we'll talk a little bit about the experiments that have caused that change. But a little bit of this understanding of organic compounds as living compounds is maintained today in our understanding of the word organic to mean natural, or containing no artificial or man-made ingredients. You may have seen this definition in organic food and other organic products. However, the understanding of organic compounds as things that are all natural or coming from nature is actually at odds with the understanding of organic compounds as those that come from living organisms, because there are many all natural things that come from nature but did not come from living organisms, like these rocks here. Historically, the divide between organic compounds and inorganic compounds came from their origin as they were isolated. Organic compounds come from living organisms, animals, plants, fungi, etc. And historically, they were difficult to purify and thermally unstable. These are different from inorganic compounds, which came from mineral sources. These compounds were often much easier to purify and thermally stable. Additionally, inorganic compounds were often much more soluble in water than organic compounds. These differences led to the belief that there was something fundamentally different about organic matter, that it possessed some vital living spark because it came from living organisms. This theory was called the theory of vitalism and played an important role in the understanding of science for a number of decades. However, the experiments that I'm about to tell you about started to cast some doubts on vitalism, as it became obvious that the type of matter in inorganic compounds and organic compounds were made up of the same elements of the periodic table, and one can interconvert between the two. The classic experiment that is often described as being the death of vitalism is one that was conducted by Friedrich Wöhler in 1828. Friedrich Wöhler was a German chemist who had discovered that if he heated an aqueous solution of ammonium cyanate, which he had isolated from lead cyanate, a mineral, he could produce urea. Urea was a well-known organic compound isolated from the urine of multiple organisms. This is such a classic example that showed that the vitalism theory was flawed, that folks have developed many resources to explain how this reaction happens. The animation that is now playing at the bottom of the screen shows how the bonds are forming and breaking between ammonium cyanate to form urea. This animation is a graphical representation of a chemical mechanism, one that we will eventually study as we progress through organic chemistry. However, this experiment was neither the first nor the most important for determining that vitalism was flawed. In 1824, Wohler had reported the synthesis of another organic compound, oxalic acid, from another inorganic compound, cyanogen. The nail was put in the coffin, however, in 1845 when a different chemist, Hermann Kolb, synthesized acetic acid from carbon disulfide. After it became clear that there was no vital spark that made organic matter different than inorganic matter, a new definition of organic chemistry was proposed. As elements of the periodic table were being discovered, it became clear that all organic compounds contained one or more carbon atoms in their structure, and thus organic chemistry became the study of the compounds of carbon. On this slide are two examples of compounds of carbon that we might study in organic chemistry. The structure on the left is the structure of isooctane, which is isolated from oil and natural gas and forms an important part of gasoline. The structure on the right is that of vitamin C, which is produced by many living organisms and is an important nutrient for others. The structure on the left shows all of the carbon and hydrogen atoms in isooctane. The structure on the right is called a bond line structure. Organic chemists developed this simplified form of representing organic molecules in order to be able to quickly represent larger and more complex compounds. We will learn about how to represent organic compounds using bond line structures in an upcoming video. However, defining the compounds of carbon as the main focus of organic chemistry did have its problems, as there were some inorganic compounds of carbon that continued to be considered inorganic, like carbon dioxide, sodium bicarbonate, and compounds containing metal atoms like dimethyl mercury. What makes carbon so special? One of the special things about carbon is its valence. Valence represents the number of bonds that an atom can make. Because carbon has four electrons in its valence shell, it can make four covalent bonds. And it can make these covalent bonds in four different bonding patterns, which means that carbon can form bonds with a large number of things in complicated patterns that give rise to complex structures pretty quickly. We'll talk more about these bonding patterns in a later video. Carbon is also capable of catenation. Carbon can form long, seemingly endless chains of single bonds between one carbon atom and another. Many of the plastics that you are familiar with contain thousands, if not millions, of carbon atoms connected in a chain. The only other atoms that are capable of catenation are those of the metals. No other non-metal can catenate quite as well as carbon can. The second best is sulfur, which is capable of achieving 8. Finally, the most important property of carbon is that its electronegativity is in the middle of the range of electronegativities. So it forms covalent bonds with a wide range of elements like fluorine, oxygen, chlorine, magnesium, lithium, zinc, hydrogen, etc. All of these bonds are covalent. Many of them are polar, but they're covalent. Carbon forms very few ionic compounds where the formal charge of the ion rests on the carbon. Up next, we're going to talk about the structural theory. Thank you for watching.